Hey folks, welcome back to my series of YouTube videos on mainframe related stuff, especially on technology and software related to MVS and later versions of this very interesting operating system such as OS390 and ZOS. Today we're going to look into something very special and something that actually has never been done on emulated S370 hardware, and that's JES3, as the title says. Now, all of you who have been running MVS 3.8 with the TK4 distribution have been running a scheduling and spooling system called JES2. And JES2 is by far the most used scheduling and spooling software out there. However, IBM to this day still offers another variant called JES3. Now, JES3 has traditionally been a software for bigger installations, especially for installations with multiple mainframes on the same site. And JES3, in fact, is one of the earliest implementations of a cluster, of a software cluster. Let's see what JES3 is. In JES3, as you can see from this picture here, you have a central or global processor, which is the processor that runs and controls the cluster and schedules work between all the local processors. Those would be other mainframes running a local version of JES3, and those execute jobs on behalf of the global processor. The global processor also controls the spool devices. And of course, just three devices such as tapes and other devices. What happens is that when you this could be one mainframe, and then this could be a channel attached other mainframe. Don't necessarily have to be the exact mainframes. It could be multiple. I think up to 16 of those. And when this global controlling processor fails, one of these can immediately take over, and everything continues to run. So the advantages of JES3 over JES2 are that you have higher uptime, because when one computer fails, another can take over. Number two, you have more throughput, because more work can be scheduled by other mainframes in the same cluster. So that's what JES3 does. JES3 has its own different command language, number one. Number two, also, it has some special commands that you can pass to it through JCL. However, most JCL, I would say 99.9% of the JCL that you execute with JES2 should also work in JES3, unless you have JES2 related features, of course, in your jobs. But we'll see that today, that most JCL jobs that we know inside TK4 run just fine. So what I've done here is I've actually uploaded a fully pre-configured and pre-installed JES3 image on Box, and I'll be putting the link to my Box shared folder, so you can just go there, and I'll put it below the video here in the description. But what you'll do is follow the link to Box and then go to this link here, and you will see this folder structure. You download everything that's in this folder structure, which would be JES3A, which is the global processor. JES3B is the local attached processor running on the same. We will have both running on the same Linux. And then you have all the main JES3 related manuals for this version, which was actually quite a feat by the community to get put back together. We have the full set of manuals. Some of them were just scanned a couple of months ago. I also want to put in a word of thanks here to Kevin Leonard. Kevin Leonard put together JES3 onto TK4 last year in October. And I worked very closely with him in testing and making sure everything works. And as I said, this is the first time that JES3 runs on an emulated mainframe. especially this version from the early 70s, has basically never run again ever since the 70s. So in a way, this is a historical feat that Kevin Leonard achieved, and I'm very thankful to him. So once you download these three folders, let's get down to how this all runs. Once you download this folders, you will have a directory structure such as this, of course, including also the manuals, which I removed here because I have them in a different location. But the main thing is to have these two folders, MVS JES3 and MVS JES-A and MVS JES3-B. We're going to have two window terminals open here. One is going to be the global processor, Hercules, and one is going to be the local attached. And also, what I have here prepared is launch icons on my desktop to launch X3270 terminals, which will attach one to port 3270 and the other one will attach to 3272. This will be the consoles to the two mainframes that we're emulating. So go into MVS JES3A and you will see you have a script here to launch the global processor. So this one. So we execute that, start JES3, and Hercules comes up, and everything is fine. And now we need to launch two consoles for the global processor. Why is that? We launch one to be, the first one is going to be, the first one we launch is going to be the MVS console. The second is going to be the JES3 console. That's the difference to JES2. In JES2, you don't have to have a dedicated console for it. In JES3, you do need its dedicated control. And in fact, the dedicated console takes over everything from MVS. So the MVS console is not going to be operational anymore as long as JES3 runs. So once we have these two consoles started, we go to the other window, go to MVS JES3. MVS JES3B, and you have a slightly different script, which is start JES3B for the local processor. So we execute that, launch that, give it its MVS console. Here you only need one because as I said before, everything is managed centrally, and so one JES3 console, which is attached to the global processor here, is enough to manage all other consoles in the cluster. But you do need an MVS console for the local processor here to get things started. So once we have these two up and running, what we do here is we, and listen carefully here, we IPL from device 148, okay? Device 148. And you should freeze this video once you got everything installed on your machine, so that it doesn't go too fast, because every step here is important. Now, and also, if you start JES3 and then stop everything and restart later, JES3 is not going to like that. JES3 really insists on being shut down gracefully. If you just yank the power from JES3 and shut down the mainframe, it will struggle to come back up again. So follow carefully here what the steps are. You IPL from device 148, okay, and the MVS console is going to come up and want some commands. So here what we answer is R for reply 00, system program SYSP equals JES3. Okay, so MVS starts to come up here. Now, one of the things that Kevin defined in this console, which I like to have differently here, it's just a matter of taste, is that he has his device, his ANSYS, the screen waits up to 46 seconds to wait to update, which for me is just too much. I like to update and scroll as it goes. So you type in KS and then go over here and change it to 001. And then if you do it like this, then the screen will scroll as you go. So you'll see JES3 is starting to come up. Also, you see here JES3 started, allocated some devices here, and now it wants to know what is this mainframe. So this is going to be how do we want it to start? So we type here 00 for W for a warm start. We don't want a cold start. We don't want to reformat the spool devices. So we type R00, W, and JES3 continues to initialize. And now it wants to know what initialization configuration we want to use here. Just go with R01 because it's asking for an answer to this question here. So R01, N, like November. Okay, and that's it. JES3 has started, and as you can see here, this console has taken over. And in fact, this console is not going to be operational anymore. So we can just overlap this. And here, once JES3 warm start wants to know what to do, and we tell it to start operation. Now, you remember that in JES2, all commands are preceded by a dollar sign, right? JES3 has its own sign to communicate to it, and that's the asterisk sign. So every command has to be preceded by asterisk. Kevin Leonard also configured so that, because it's tedious, it's not natural to go reach out to the asterisk, you can also put in an 8, just the same. But let's keep things clean, and let's use asterisk, start, as for start, JSS. Okay, now JES3 will continue to start the TK4 environment. Everything stays exactly the same. To scroll between pages in the X3270 terminal, you have to press clear, which on my 3270 is configured as Control, Alternate, and C. So there's three keys involved here: Control key, the Alt key, the Alternate key, and C. And you can see that my TK4 environment is coming up. By the way, you can use all the MVS commands just the same here. If I type display all jobs, you'll see that it shows here in a slightly different format the answer to my query. So MVS is continuing to come up here, and all the system programs. We have already TSO, and VTAM is already up. Everything's up and running. So once this has finished initializing, once we've gone this far, we can start to initialize the other node in the cluster. And we go over here to this, to the system B, and you IPL from a different device. Okay, pay attention here. It's IPL 348, not 148 as in system A. In system B, you IPL from 348. I'll highlight it again here. Press enter, and this machine starts to execute. We do the same thing here again. Reply 00, system program, SYSP equals J3 for JES3. Okay, again, we change the console settings with K space S, and I'll change it to 001. I want it to scroll as things happen. And here's JES3 starting to come up here as well. So far, it's exactly the same as for system A, but things are going to change now very soon. Because we don't reapply here with L for local. Okay, we want this to be a local attached processor, meaning this is not going to be the controller in the cluster. This machine here is going to be the controller, and this is just going to be a device that executes jobs and therefore extends throughput of the whole complex. So we reply with R00, L. And that's it. On this side, things are much simpler. You don't actually have to do anything. JES3 is already up and running, as you can see. And that's the only task executing on this machine is really actually just JES3. You won't see anything else. You don't have TSO and all the other stuff running here because that's executing on this machine. So at this point, we have the complex is almost all up and running. We can look at the status of the complex by typing *i, *s for status. And you see that TK4A is online, IPL'd. TK4B, which is this machine here, is offline and not IPL'd. And that's because we need to tell JES3 to turn this one online and start accepting jobs. So we do this with asterisk V TK4B online. And by doing this, we achieve something that has been never done before on emulated mainframes. And that's TK4B, as you can see here, the system is now active. And we also see it here, TK4B varied online on global. So to control, we can do I, S, check the status. And you'll see that both processors, the global and the local, are now both online. TK4A is online, IPL'd. TK4B is now online and IPL'd. So both are now in the cluster and fully operational. How do these two nodes talk to each other? That's obviously no TCP IP or anything like that. And the way this is accomplished is because one of the community members of Hercules last year wrote a channel-to-channel device emulator, this here, which is able to do, which is able to couple the two machines, and therefore the two machines talk over an attached channel. You should see this one here as well. Where is it? Maybe further down. Yeah, here it is. No, that's it's further down. If we look at the device, it's going to be a device 500, which is even further down, which attaches to this device. And in fact, Hercules is telling us that it's talking to another node here, which is this one, over. And of course, the channel-to-channel adapter behind the scenes talks over TCP/IP, and that's why you see a local device here. That's local host. These two machines don't have to be on the same computer. They could be on two totally different computers. As long as they can ping each other and connect to each other's ports, this will work just fine. And by doing this, you would effectively achieve high availability, because if one host goes down where the global is running, the other one will become the new global. And again, you can have, I think, as far as 16 mainframes cluster to each other with JES3. So let's try and see what, you know, what changes once you have a JES3 complex up and running. Let's attach a, let's launch a new 3270 emulator, and you're connected to VTAM. We type Herc01. By the way, the password here for Herc01 is Herc01. And in the images that you're downloading from my website, and we can go and launch any job. Let's launch one of the example jobs, the prime number generators, and let's execute that. Let's write Herc01. P. It goes to message class A. Let's see here what happened. You won't see anything here unless, even when sometimes JES3 will schedule work to run on a local attached processor, you will not really see anything in the console. You may see sometimes the CPU usage going up. But other than that, there's really, it all happens behind the scenes. But we do see here in the JES3 console that Hercules 01 entered its processing in its JES3 with priority 15. And it was selected to run on TK4A. And again, that's a decision by JES3. Sometimes it will execute things on the other one. Started and ended. And since this was class A, we should be able to go and see the output. And you will see that the printer output looks different in JES3 compared to JES2. Now the printers are attached to system A, so we go there and let's see which one was last updated. It is June 3rd, so printer E, that's class A. Let's scroll printer E, and you see immediately things look slightly different here. That's how output looks on JES3. That's the banner page here on JES3. It tells you the job name, the job number, which printer it is, and the JES3 messages also look different. If you remember, JES2 messages are always preceded by HASP for Houston automated spooling program. And on JES3, it's preceded, all messages are preceded by IAT. I don't know off the top of my head what IAT stands for. But here you see it ran, found 303 prime numbers. And here's the JCL. And that's it. Let's go see how we can actually do more stuff with JES3. Let me show you here how to send specifically. So you can use JCL to send to jobs specifically to a given system. So let's do that here. Let's put message class A. And the way to do this is by writing a card immediately after the job card. If you put in a JES3 message like this, main system equals TK4B, it will just, that's the way to tell JES3 to send this job to execute in this machine. And so let's make sure there's enough prime numbers to actually see the CPU here on the system B go up. If you watch this carefully, you will see the system, the MIPS indicator go up. And let's submit this one. Yep. You saw here. Okay, so it gave us an error message because we scheduled the job to run here and we have RackF, the security software installed. So that's what it's asking for here. But as you can see, system B already answered here. And let's execute this one again. Yep, so it ran on this machine. And we can see it from the fact that that JES3 is telling us that it was run on TK4B. But something failed again. Attempt to access system. There is a issue here with RackF, the security software that TK4 includes by default. I don't know what the original password is they had set up on this system. I guess, you know, once you obtain those images, reset the passwords to something that you like, and and then this will not create problems. But it is clearly sending its job here to system B. And let's see if it works fine if I send it to processor A. There's an append here that happened. 80A, don't remember what append 80A is, but that's always a good exercise. How do you check out what 80A, append code 80A means? So IBM will tell you immediately. An error occurred when the system tried to process perform a get. Okay, it ran out of memory. So I guess what happens is that my job here is a little bit too big. Let's make the calculation a little smaller. Yeah, and this time it ran just fine. So it was just slightly big. So let's see if we can execute it this time on system, on node B. I have a feeling it's not gonna go through. Oh, actually, let me see. Let's check here. It went by too fast. Let's run it again. Oh yeah, it did go through. Yeah, it executed on TK4B, and this time there was no error. It was just a little bit too big a calculation for 16 megabytes of RAM on these machines to handle. So that's it. So he actually managed to run a job on the second processor. But again, if you don't include this card here, then JES3 is going to decide itself when it needs to spread out jobs to other machines. So far everything works fine. We've seen how to look at the app output. Let's look a little bit how to control the cluster. Again, you had I, S will show you the status of the whole complex. Log writer. There was a command log writer. I don't remember all the commands here off the top of my head, but the manuals include all the hundreds of commands you can put into JES3. The main ones we've looked at here. Any time you want to send a command to JES3 on the local, you would have to use T and then the name of the processor you want to talk to in the complex, and then you would tell it and so this is a command that gets sent to system B, it did answer us saying that there's no jobs in TK4B running. So any command you want to send to B, you would send from here with asterisk T, TK4B, etc. Now, how do we shut down the complex? So here is one part where you need to be really careful, because JES3 is not going to like ungraceful shutdowns when you restart the complex later on. It's going to start complaining, and I've had several instances where it didn't come up at all anymore and had to reinstall from scratch. So obviously reinstalling from scratch, as long as you're playing with it, is not a problem, and as long as you make backups of your data inside the mainframe, and as I've shown with my previous video a couple of weeks ago. But let's see how to gracefully shut down this complex. So you start by telling system B to stop JES3. So first we have to vary this one offline, because right now it's online. So we do asterisk V TK4B offline. And it tells us, yes, it's offline now. Let's just check to make sure. I, comma S. Yes, status is now offline. So now that it's not participating in the complex anymore, we can tell it to exit JES3 on this processor here. Right, so we do that by saying TK4B return. Return is the command to JES3 to exit, to end. By doing that, we see here now that JES3 has ended. And once this has ended, what we can do here is say Z end of day, and then quies, and that's it. This machine has stopped. We can close this console and type quit, and this one is done. Now, this one is a little bit more complicated. So once we've shut down the other processor, what we do here, we initiate the shutdown of all the services running on this machine. Because if you remember, we have TSL and VTAM, everything is running here. All this need to end. So we can use the ESP pilot that comes with TK4 to shut down everything. And we do this by saying force BSB pilot shut fast. So maybe I'll put it in all caps, makes it easier to read. Force BSP pilot, that's this job here. We tell it, we send it a message saying shut fast, shut everything down fast. And here you see the command, the message from BSP fast shutdown was requested. And it's starting to shut down TSO first, obviously, not accepting logins anymore. And this will take a little while. I really, while we wait here, a couple of things. I really encourage you to play with this and read the manuals that I included in the download link that you see below this video. Everything else should continue to work just fine. You work in TSO, all your tape jobs, everything will be continue to work just the same. The only thing is that the output is going to look a little different, as we saw. And you want to be more careful here with graceful shutdowns, because JES3 really doesn't like ungraceful shutdowns. Here it's continuing to go down, sending second warning message. It's kind of like in Linux when you shut down and then you give it a minute, it will tell you going down, and then you'll see it starting to actually shut down. Same thing, same idea here. One thing here, by the way, is that I played with the configuration of this mainframe a little bit and gave it two CPUs. And by giving it two CPUs, that royally confused JES3 and refused to start. JES3 does not like any changes in configuration of devices attached. So it's really just the way it comes delivered by the author, Kevin Leonard, and as I'm giving you for download. By the way, this TK4 version is update 7 from about October last year. The one that you can download from Jürgen Winkelmann's website is now update 8, and he's working on update 9. However, I think that Jürgen, the TK4 maintainer, and Kevin Leonard, the JES3 maintainer, are working on including JES3 as an option in update 10 of TK4, which is going to come out maybe this year, later this year at some point. So I'm very, very excited about this. Having both JES2, JES3 is just awesome and shows what the power of community cooperation can achieve. I mean, this software, JES3, was just dead for the last 40 years, basically. And somebody had a tape of JES3, and then Kevin Leonard starting to put it back together and make it work. And then Jürgen, the maintainer of TK4, helped with making it work in TK4. And about 10, 12 people helped in the testing over through an email list. And I was one of the active participants. And I'm just very thankful to the community. This is such a great hobby to have, to run a mainframe on my laptop here, especially having a whole complex running on my laptop. It would have just been unthinkable even 20 years ago or 15 years ago. And software that was supposed to be defunct has been resurrected here to run on this amazing environment. So it's just fascinating. All right, so I think it's mostly ended. Let's see what JES3 did here. Yep, we're down to only JES3. That's the remaining task running on this machine. So we exit by typing asterisk return. And you see now it's stuck on this side. And if I show here what's running on this machine, there's nothing running. JES3 has ended. And now we continue as usual. Finish SMF processing with ZEOD and then Quies. And here everything stopped. This looks fine. Let's quit. And that's it. Both consoles went dead. And we're back again to the Linux shell. And that's it. So this is JES3, and I hope you'll have time to download and start learning JES3. I think it's fascinating. And thank you for watching. Please subscribe to my channel if you want to see any future videos. And